Good evening, everyone. We'll bring the meeting to a beginning. My name is Gordon Mann. I'm from the Philadelphia-based advisory firm Public Financial Management, joined by my colleagues here today, Meredith Brett and Ashley Lewis. We're also joined by Fred Chapman from the Department of Community and Economic Development. In 2009, the Pennsylvania Department of Community and Economic Development designated Reading City Government as financially distressed according to the Municipalities Financial Recovery Act, also known as Act 47. The Commonwealth appointed PFM to serve as the recovery coordinator, and we have been serving in that capacity since late 2009. Act 47 was amended in 2014 so that it requires us as coordinator to file a report this year with the city and the Commonwealth stating the financial condition of the City of Reading and what we recommend in terms of the city's Act 47 status going forward. The law allows four different paths forward. One, that the city has met the conditions it needs to exit Act 47 successfully. Two, that the Secretary of DCD could declare a financial emergency. Three, that the city adopt a three-year exit plan. And fourth, disincorporation, which is not an option here in Reading. It is barred to municipalities with a paid police and fire department. So on March 28th, PFM filed a report with Mayor Scott, with each member of council, and the other parties as required by law. We have placed a copy of that report in the City Council Clerk's office, and we've placed legal notice in the newspaper as required. And if anybody here would like a report, I actually brought extra copies with me. The report, as you will read, finds that we recommend that the City of Reading adopt a three-year exit plan extending the city's Act 40 2022, and it could end sooner than that. Our report reviews the city's financial progress that it's made, and we have determined that while the progress has been significant, the city is not yet ready to exit oversight. We have recommended the three-year plan be adopted. To exit oversight, the city has to balance revenues with expenditures and continue to have the strong financial performance. But equally important, it needs to have the strong financial management in place and to give its new leaders in that regard some space and some time to come together and work as a team so that they're able to tackle the challenges in front of them. Law requires us to hold a public meeting to receive comments on our report, and this is that meeting. I'm going to open up the microphone here in a second, and folks are welcome to come up and make comments. I was going to say we're going to limit comments to 5 minutes if there's a lot of people scheduled to speak, but there's not. So we will, as long as you stay on point, we will allow the time to be open-ended. Again, we do ask that the comments remain focused on the city's financial condition, the financial condition report, and related matters. And with that said, we will open up the mic to whoever wants to speak.
Hello, my name's John Heffron. I own buildings on the 100 block of South 6th Street, south side of the city. Since January 14th, I've been coming to city council meetings, most of them, and making presentations like this with these photos that I have. The streets that I covered before were 1, 2, and 300 blocks of South 6th, 5, 6, and 700 Franklin, 6 and 700 Chestnut. This area is the 8th and Muhlenberg area where the train trestle goes in, nice little pocket. Nice little neighborhood there that should be turned around for, I picture millennials with their little kids and bicycles in this area, cars not allowed. What a perfect spot for it. Anyway, for those of you I gave photos to, I don't have a whole lot of copies, but some of these photos are covering the conditions of the properties in this area and how they've been allowed to fall in disrepair. The first one is 341 South 8th Street. It's owned by TEH Realty, according to the records. I have experience with TEH Realty from 117, 119 South 6th Street. They're horrible. They're property managers. Apparently, they also own property in the city. They stink. Pardon my bluntness. The amazing to me, though, the second picture is also the same building. There's only $150 in fees on fines on this building, which I find to be incredible. It's a 14-room rooming house, which probably helped destroy that area. The next one is 802 Muhlenberg. It's vacant. It is owned by someone who lives in Allentown. There is $2,000 owed on that property. And this is the point of my presentation, what the city is missing out on. The next photo is 835 Muhlenberg on the corner. You see the couch there on the side street there. It's in deplorable condition. The corner there at the bottom right-hand side of the corner, that building's going to collapse. This owner is on Maple Street in Reading, same zip code. $14,140 owed in housing fees, $6,428 quality of life and work order fees, $20,568 on one building. Next one was on Niversink, a house I took three pictures of, and the lot next door. No reports on this. I didn't pull any reports on this, but the condition of the house was horrible, and the lot is full of trash. Kids are walking through that. The next picture is two houses on 300 block of 8th Street that are collapsing into each other. It's kind of hard to tell from the shot, but when you look at it from the street, they look like they're from the roof down. And there's a picture here, two pictures here of 334, my glasses are a little challenging, 334 Southeast Street. Beautiful house on the end of the street before you hit the railroad trestle. And the second picture is how he fenced in the yard and put a little park in there. He allowed me to use these photos at these presentations. I just wanted to point out the way this area should look when somebody does something right. The next couple of photos are the restaurant in 9th and Laurel. It's vacant. Don't know how long it's been vacant. The side windows are boarded up, so people driving up Laurel Street see that. Used to be a nice restaurant. There's no reason, if the area is fixed, why it can't be again, and that one would be paying taxes. The last picture is Niversink and McIlvain. Am I saying that right, McIlvain? Two boarded up properties, and when you drive onto McIlvain, there's four or five abandoned properties there. These buildings are basically behind the Laurel recycling place. I already complained about Laurel with the trash on the side, and one of the inspectors said it didn't qualify as trash on the streets. So I put in a phone call to him. He hasn't called me back yet. The point of all this is, and I read through this report, and I've got a lot of notes here. I'm not going to go through all of them because it's too much. But on page 8, I wrote some notes about what's the salary of an inspector, how many no-shows daily, weekly, monthly, and yearly, how many of the no-show fines and others are not collected, what is the cost of not having a director of administrative services, what has that cost the city since it's such an important thing to get out of Act 47. Down at the bottom of the page, I wrote, the redevelopment authority must sell sitting properties or give them away for someone else to maintain. I got a list from Linda of the properties that are owned by our city, Reading, Redevelopment Authority, and other ones, and some of these properties have three addresses. Three addresses. A postal service, 33 years. A boss, a mailman for 10, a boss for 23. I know the postal system. I never saw anything so stupid in all my life. An easy cleanup, and people keep telling me it's because of the deeds. Okay, so fix the deeds, so you don't have this massive confusion about these properties and throughout the city. I made a proposal to city council about, now me personally, I pay $100 per building on registration fee. I paid a $165 gross receipts tax, and I also pay a $55 business tax, okay? Why don't you double my registration fee to $200 on each building, eliminate the gross receipts, and eliminate business? Why are we collecting three taxes when we could collect one? This is stupid. How much money are we spending to collect all these taxes that don't get collected? There's apparently a $20 per capita tax and a $10 per capita tax. I didn't even know these things existed until I read this report. And only 22% of those get collected. So how much time is spent running around after that tax that nobody pays? Because people figured out that they don't have to pay because nobody's going to come after them. Eliminate it. Do something else. Every report I've pulled of slumlords, some three dozen so far, and I've also taken the same kinds of pictures that City Council has, have hundreds and thousands of unpaid fees, fines, and taxes. How bad are the actual Rawa mistakes, the water company? They made two massive mistakes on two of my buildings. I bought three buildings on the same day, all vacant. They made two massive errors on two of my buildings when they got reopened, when I finally got them done. They were not collecting what they were supposed to be collecting from me. I had to tell them. I had to tell Rawa. So if two of my three buildings, my vacant buildings that are now very viable buildings, that's been done. How much more of this is going on throughout the city? Why is Codes not notified of court decisions regarding fine payments? Why are three district judges in particular? This is a top official that told me this. I'm not going to give their name. They said that Dana D'Amato And several other department heads actually told me this part of this little story. Dana DeMatta was one of the best they ever had in Coates. The man was fired, and the official told me that was because three district judges went to the mayor complaining about DeMatta trying to run their courts. No, he was trying to figure out why they were allowing slumlords to get away with murder. Okay. And Gordon, you can tell me when to shut up. So, this one here, real estate tax at the top of page 12. It says $24.5 million will come from this source, including delinquent payments. That didn't make any sense to me. So where is that happening with delinquent payments? If they're delinquent, then or they're not getting collected, right? Or maybe they're just getting collected late. And again, you go back to how much does it cost to collect these delinquent taxes? How many lawyers' fees? How many? At right above earned income tax on the same page, it says this translates to minimal growth in total real estate tax revenues. They increased from $24.5 million budgeted in 2019 to $24.8 million in 2022. That's ridiculous. Also, further on in this report, it talks about the stagnation of wages and real estate values. Gee, guess what that does? You don't get people going to your stores. You don't get people buying up the properties and fixing them and getting them turned around. So you got MedEd customers, UGI customers, Rawa customers, and then they're going down to the bodega to buy something, and they're going on the Penn Street to buy something. You're not getting all that because of the condition of Reading housing. All of this goes back to what I've been screaming about for the last 4 months. The condition of Reading housing and the departments that are supposed to be responsible for this is horrible. The morale in City Hall is horrible. The communication between departments is terrible. And I know about lack of communication with the Postal Service. I worked for what at the time was the biggest communications company in the world, and we sucked at talking to each other. I just went and did my job. I didn't depend on the boss at 30th Street headquarters. I just did my job. But you don't have that with a situation like this. Codes and Building and Trades and the Preservation Society and this one and that one, they all got to be talking to each other with the same computers, and it doesn't seem to be happening. No fault of theirs, it's just what the system is right now. So where's the IT expert that maybe grew up in the city that gives a damn about the city will come in and fix it for us? I talked to a couple of people in the IT department, and I didn't get much out of them. And I'm not good with computers, so you can't hold me to that. Page 17 addresses Rawa and water filtration and distribution system from city government and pays the city an agreed upon amount under the terms of its lease arrangement. Under the terms of the federal consent decree, the city also transfers $3 million a year into its general fund from the sewer fund. The baseline holds that transfer payment flat through 2022. That's because housing stinks. More economic reasons to fix housing. And there's graphs down at the bottom that debt service, $11,358,000, other personnel, premium pay at $1 million, fringe benefits. I don't know what that fringe benefits means. But if a certain department guy is making $125,000 and he's getting 8 hours of comp time to do a particular job that he should be doing anyway for $125,000, maybe that's part of the fringe benefits problem that we got in the city. And I talked to Mr. Deming about this before when I had a meeting with him. Your gross receipts tax, by the way, speaking Postal Service, not this year, but last year, Keystone Collection started doing the gross receipts tax. The letter goes out bulk mail. No address correction requested. Costs about 10 cents per letter. No address correction requested. Now, when I was in Coates a couple weeks ago, they had 600 letters lined up of mail that came back to them for the registration fees that were not collected, just the $100 registration fees. They were returned to sender. Now they got to try to track all those people down. So what happens with Keystone Collections when the person that looks at this growth, I almost threw it in the trash. I almost put it in my burn pile with my junk mail, because that's, you guys refer to that as junk mail. We call that third-class mail in the Postal Service. It gets tossed. They don't see first class there, or they don't, see, or there's not an, even an address correction requested. Most people, especially in the city, will not have a clue what address correction requested means, and they'll toss it, thinking it's junk mail. That's your bill for your gross receipts tax. So somebody said to me, well, they must have some kind of system in place at Keystone Collections to let them know that certain people didn't pay. Well, okay, in the meantime, the city's waiting for its gross receipts tax fund. So how much money are we even losing? Is Keystone Collections, I understand they're supposedly doing better than the city in collecting this tax. Is that true? Marcia? Maybe, maybe not. I don't know about that. I haven't investigated that. Are they or are they not? And again, kill the gross receipts tax, kill the business tax, jump my registration fee to $200 a building. Now, that's just my particular circumstance. I understand there are other circumstances involved in that may be more complicated than mine. But there's a lot of rental property in city. So if you double the registration fee and kill the other two taxes, you're not only going to get more money, because I only paid $55 plus $165 for those two taxes, I paid $300 for the registration fees. So if you jump into $600, you're doubling what you're getting, and you're eliminating two taxes that the city has to collect. This is just kind of just stupid obvious to me. And I keep finding one thing after another with this. With the codes department, there are 17 inspectors that can interpret the codes 17 different ways. The codes book is from 2012. I went down to Lancaster City and talked to supervisor of codes there. There's seven inspectors and one boss for the city of Lancaster. Seven inspectors and one boss. We got 17 and three, I think, or 20 and three. Not exactly sure. Have to ask Jason that. Now, that's compared to a population of 88,000 here to 60,000 in Lancaster. And how many more rentals does Reading have? Because it's notorious for rentals. But gee, if you slam these slumlords, maybe you get rid of some of these rentals, especially the single houses. Instead of letting the buildings fall down, like happened to my two unit, the single house on my block, the only porch house on the block, in the Prince Historic District since 1982, that I told the city five times was going to fall down, and it fell down. It cost me $4,000 to my building next door that I paid for myself, including putting a fence up so the drug dealers don't go in my backyard and shoot up. Now, the police have effectively eliminated a lot of that nonsense. But still, I still keep finding little bags on 100 block South 6th Street when I sweep the street. And I've found 8 hypodermic needles over the course of the last 14 years. Not bad, but not good. One was outside of my 2-unit where the three-year-old in my second floor apartment lived. Right on my pavement. Hypodermic needle. Okay, thank you. Just some suggestions that I made, and I'll end it with this, with the codes department. Put the 17 inspectors in particular areas, like a mailman. Put them in the same areas. Why are they running all over the city putting fires out? Because that's what they're doing. Why are you giving 120 days to a slumlord when the building's already done? Once the building is done and it's been passed, why are you giving 120 days to fix something? 60 days, tops. You're clogging up the system with that kind of nonsense. Why is a no-show fee $150, a second one $300, the third one $400? Why does a notorious slumlord that owns the big, beautiful four-story building on 6th of Franklin, of course it would be beautiful if she didn't own it, but it's been vacant for the 14 years I've been there, why does she care about a $150 no-show fee when it's going to cost $400,000 to fix that building? Why does she care? Why is it a quality of life fee, $25 only? When every time I drive up 500 Franklin Street, 520 Franklin Street, it's got 5 and 6 and 7 and 10 bags outside their building every day. It should go from 25 to 50 to 100 to slam them. If district judges are letting people get away with this stuff, then embarrass them with the news media. Embarrass them. Ask them why. Why is this happening? I'm sorry, there's one last thing. The big thing is getting some inspiration to the codes department. These people need to be inspired. These people are good people. They need to be inspired. And the motto being not there anymore, I don't know how much that affected that. I don't know how bad it was before he got in, while he was in, after he's in. I don't know that. I don't work there. But it seems to me that there is a lot of easy fixes for some problems, that the city will start collecting this money and not have to worry about Act 47. Then you can fix the payments and the roofs and hire the cops and hire the firemen and build the buildings and all of this all to nice, instead of a vicious cycle that we got now, you start getting this stuff fixed and you got a positive cycle. And then nice people start coming into the city and want to live there, want to shop there, and want to work there. Okay, thank you.
Good evening, citizens of Reading, and officials for the city of Reading as well. My name is Sheila Perez, and I'm here to talk about some concerns. First of all, as a concerned citizen and one that has persistently worked to study the economics or lack thereof regarding our community and economic revitalization, redevelopment of our city, its businesses, and the successes of those families within the city that diligently work towards sustaining the economy or budgets of our municipal and county corporations. One of the factors that very much concerns me is this earned income tax that has been charged to the city residents at a rate of 3.2% versus the commuter tax for those that commute into the city for work at a rate of 1.2%. Yet they are living largely over the bridge with the monies that we are providing in this city for their salaries. Now, back in February, March of 2016, in one of the strategic finance meetings with the council members, one of our council members here present today made a reference to the fact that she liked the fact that the earned income tax and the commuter tax was being charged during Act 47, which was working in our favor, but that she would like to see what we could do to continue to charge that tax even after the exiting Act 47. Now, mind you, these taxes were instituted to help us exit Act 47 and were never made to sustain the income of the city other than acting in that capacity. Now, another council member, also present in that meeting, made a reference that it could not be done because the commuter tax as well as the income tax were taxes that were solely tied to Act 47 to help us get out of it and not to continue after exiting Act 47. Additionally, our city manager, acting city manager, made reference several times about his concern with the fact that the earned income tax and the commuter tax is going away. And as a result, he feels that the city is not yet ready to do away with these taxes, unless, of course, City Council comes up with some creative way to make up for that loss. That would mean that if the City Council members are going to come up with a creative way to be able to continue to charge an unjustifiable earned income tax and a commuter tax on residents that are already strapped with paying the highest taxes in the state, okay? And then without calling those taxes, and then the city's not financially, in my opinion, stable enough to be exiting Act 47 until we can sustain ourselves without having to charge those two taxes, both the city residents, again, 3.2%, versus the commuter tax at 1.2%. As well as, I don't understand why we, the citizens who live in the city, are being penalized, having to pay a higher tax than the commuters who come in taking a huge chunk of money with the jobs that they take away from our current citizens. See, I'm upset about people going over the bridge talking crap on our city, but yet they love to commute in, massive exodus in and out of the city to come take our jobs and live the ludicrous jobs, lives that our tax dollars are able to provide. So just think how we would do if we were able to keep a large portion of that money in-house and allow our people to live with that pride inside the city, because it's pride that fixes the city, that lowers crime to begin to help us move forward in our economy. Now, let's also talk about the revenue that is allegedly being generated by the already illegal Reading Recycling Program, Liberty Law Group, Citizens Action lawsuit, which claimed that they won the lawsuit last in the beginning of January. But no one's talking to that. Now, according to the records, the program under the collection right now of the Reading Area Water Authority is alleged to have generated back in 2016 over $8.4 million in revenue. But that was the year that only $150,000 is alleged to have gone back into our city budget out of $8.4 million. Additionally, let us not forget that there were new recycling trucks that were purchased by the city of Reading under Vaughan's administration, but could not be used because of their size, dimensions, but there is no report to the citizens of Reading to inform them where those trucks are, what have we done with them, have they been sold, were they bidded on, were they sold appropriately, if so, how much did we get for them, what was the return on our investment? No one's talking about it. I personally am calling for a forensic audit of the recycling program monies generated, because there is currently no clear picture as to how that program is being run or where the monies are being spent. And I highly doubt that out of 100,000 people approximate, the only return on recycling revenue to the city budget was only $150,000. If it's costing us $8.2 million to recycle, then maybe we should think about not recycling at all, because it's too expensive to the citizens and not enough is coming back in terms of return. I'd rather take that product and sell it myself and put that money that I get back into an escrow account so that I could pay my taxes, because maybe that way I'd probably get a better return on investment than $150,000 for the entire city of Reading. Now let's look at the underassessed values of the properties in the downtown economic artery of our cities, as is the case for the property owned by Mr. Al Schumann at 645 Penn Street. Its current value assessed is only $1.7 million, which the ILEED Center Charter School building, which is only two blocks away, has an assessed value of over $10 million on their property, located two blocks away at 401 429 Penn Street. Now, the Ely Charter Schools assessed land tax for 1.42 acres of land is over $2 million, while the Santander Plaza, which belongs to our city Reading at 450 Penn, with 1.49 acres of land, assessed at only $322,000. Across the street from the Ely Charter School, let's talk about the Reading Eagle Industrial Building at the 300 block of Penn Street, with 1.96 acres of land, assessed at only $422,000. It appears to be a pattern associated with those involved in the revitalization of the city of Reading and the cartel. So if you're plugged in, you'll get a nice low assessed rate. And the county has to be in cahoots with this, because we can't get an assessed value, total land assessed value, without having the county involved. What is failing is our ability to get on board. Okay, never mind the fact the majority of the larger parcels pay little to nothing in terms of real estate tax, because they are either alleged nonprofit developers with a 501c3 status or a 501c4 status, which means you pay taxes. But when I looked into what the value of those parcels that paid taxes under the 501c4, they're equal to the assessed value that Mr. Schumann and Mr. Boscoff were getting for their parcels downtown, a couple blocks away. I stood away from the structure because I wanted people to focus on the land. We're talking about feet across the street from each other and the disparities in terms of assessed value compared to those who are plugged in and those who are not. Now, Additionally, in my opinion, what is failing is our inability to get on boards, commissions, and authorities, while due to an administrative oversight policy that is used, in our opinion, as a gerrymandering tool to orchestrate appointments and disqualify our very own taxpaying constituents, while it has allowed, under broad discretion, the appointments of outsiders that don't live in the city of Reading to be appointed to multiple boards, commissions, and authorities that work against the interests of the city of Reading, as is the case with Mr. Lee Olson. Kumru Township resident, architect for the 2020 Downtown Master Plan, whose business is located in Burn Township, was made executive director of the Blighted Property Review Committee for the City of Reading, also appointed to the Reading Planning Commission, also appointed to the Mount Penn Preserve Board, also appointed to the Pagoda Foundation, the Berks County Planning Commission as well. Please keep in mind that the architect for the 2020 Master Plan, Mr. Olson, knew which properties were going to be targeted in the downtown area, which would then help facilitate the takeover through eminent domain. Once targeted or certified as blighted by the Property Review Committee, which would then feed the targeted properties to the Redevelopment Authority to take over under eminent domain for their proposed land bank. For years, our assets have been undersold or not protected by our legislatures, as is the case of the city council members, as well as our past mayors. For many years, we have complained about the way businesses have been conducted here and the monopoly that has been allowed to take place that benefited primarily one benefactor, Albert Boscoff, our City Reading, and Direct Link, a for-profit company. Now, just think of the benefits to a for-profit company that inherits 18.3 acres of land with a retail value of $11.4 million and a sex tax value of $9.2 million. And they were allowed to purchase that property as a for-profit company for only $200,000. Now, that for-profit company took net worth went up by $11.2 million with only a $200,000 investment. When the for-profit got their hand on the deed, they took it to the bank and were able to get over $8 million worth of loans against that land that they just purchased for $200,000. So his additional net worth...
I need you to bring this back to the city's financial condition. You've got your comments here, and they're good, and we'll read them.
Okay. All right. This is about finances, because you're talking about how it's affecting us in terms of the underpayments, under sale of the properties. But it seems that every single time we want to educate the people, everybody tries to shut us down.
I'm not trying to shut you down. This meeting here legally is about the city's financial condition. So just keep it focused on city government.
Okay, the financial condition, yet the person before me was busy talking about properties, which really has nothing to do with would you allow me to finish? I think the citizens would like us to finish, would you not? Okay. Zoning laws that are not allowing the progress of our city's business district, inhibiting the growth of our economy. Laws that need to be compared to zoning laws that are working in our adjacent areas, as is the case with West Reading, Lancaster, Allentown, and make it happen here. When we have a zoning and planning commission where members have served over 10 years, we have compromised ourselves and have allowed for alliances to form that work against the people, perhaps also allowing an environment that will be conducive to a pay-to-play environment, as was the case with our past mayors and our past president of city council and the school board. I believe it is in the citizens' best interest to retire all of the current zoning and planning commission members and nominate all new people that live within the city limits in order to allow them the ability to have input into the future revitalization of their city. The administrative policy must be done away with, because city council members cannot and should not be allowed to disqualify city candidates when it comes to nomination petitions that they themselves are in violation of that very same policy they are using to enforce to disqualify us. Also, the fact that the 2013 and 2014 PFM allowed our city council members and administration to appoint themselves majority panel members. 9 out of 11 panelists were either city council members, auditors, the mayor, employees of the city, or the wife of an employee under the city, as was the case with Rosemary Vitale. The same people that needed to approve the proposals of the Home Rule Charter Commission were also the members of that commission. How is that not a conflict of interest? How is it possible that council can alter Home Rule Charter to benefit themselves? How is it possible that even though the Home Rule Charter states that under Article 11, Section 1109, initiative and referendums, the limit on the number of initiative and referendums are to be 2, but yet that year they allowed themselves to play 6 on the ballot. Yet in November, the proposal was a total of 6. In the letter to the Reading Eagle dated April 2nd, 2019, from Acting Solicitor Elizabeth Kraft regarding 2-term limits references the following: however, as public officials, we must follow proper procedure and adhere to the law. As it relates to the term limits, citizens' initiative, which the city clerk refused to accept the over 2,000 plus signatures on April 1st, 2019, demanding that a 2-term limit ballot question be placed on the ballot, but not and amend their Home Rule Charter. Lastly, I'm concerned that our City Council have failed in their fiduciary responsibility to protect our assets by never filing criminal complaints to recover over $15,000 in embezzled monies by the past Mr. Daniel Robinson while he was the Executive Director of the Community and Economic Development Office. But City Council did call for his resignation by not following through on the $550,000 low interest 10-year loan that was due back in February 2016 from our city, Reading, to ensure that he paid it back. And even though John Slifko and Jeffrey Wallman called for the certified letter demanding proof, City Council never finalized these notes. Instead, continued to do business with a person who has also yet to finish paying $750,000 tied to the Buttonwood Gateway, $4.2 million in water tied to companies tied to our city, Reading. The millions of dollars that were written off in community and economic development loans claiming that business owners cannot be found. However, Mr. D'Amato was promoted to code inspector, knowing that he failed to pay a $50,000 loan. Lastly, I would like to leave you with these words that come from the Pennsylvania Municipal League 2019 Legislative Priorities. Under tax-exempt entities on page 37, it states, municipalities host a multitude of tax-exempt entities, as in the case of Reading, we're almost at 40%. While offering important community services, tax-exempt entities do not directly contribute to the tax base. This creates, and this is where I highlight, an inequitable burden on the entities that do pay taxes. Municipalities and taxpayers need relief from the tax-exempt burden. Regular reviews of each tax-exempt entity's designation, as well as continuation of a high threshold to meet that designation, are also important aspects to relieving the tax burden on the other entities that do not sustain our tax. With that said, I want to inform you that when I did my tax assessment study of the properties located in the downtown economic of our city, I noticed a direct correlation between the properties that pay little to nothing in terms of taxes and that they are very well connected to the revitalization and development in our city, as well as in the disparities in terms of parcels for those that were not so well connected. We must call for a forensic audit of those properties and so see what they should be paying versus what they are paying now and what they have failed to pay all the years being tax exempt. I expect some response to any and all of these claims as it relates to Act 47. Thank you.
If there's anyone else who'd like to come to the podium and speak, welcome to do so. I do ask again. Remember, this meeting is to address the financial condition report in Act 47 and things related to the city's financial condition. So,
good evening, citizens of the city of Reading. My one concern is that my name's Nate Rivera, and I live in the city of Reading. I'm a citizen of the city of Reading. You know what? I'm tired of coming into these meetings, and we say that we have a plan, and let's be honest with ourselves. There's no plan to exit Act 47. If you're telling me that the medical bills are going to go from $2.4 to $4 million, am I correct, approximately? Can I quote you on that?
You're talking about the employee contribution.
Employee contribution towards medical.
Correct.
It's going to go up. If you go out of Act 47, you'll lose automatically $3 million. Let's say the hike on the medical expenses is going to be $2 million. Right then and there's a $5 million gap. How are you going to overcome that? I want to say this publicly. I think we need to keep it real. There's no way of out of Act 47 unless we get a real plan to get these houses, our house stock, in order and get them into the tax rolls. That's the only way out. We need to bring employments into the city, and we need to get the community involved. There's no real plan, and I'm looking forward to hearing the plan in the next 30 days. I know you guys are gonna put it together, but let's keep it real. There's no real plan to get out of Act 47. There's no real plan because the commuter tax, $3 million. The gap, how are you gonna get the money unless you get the water rates up again? We're using the Water Authority and the Parking Authority as a piggy bank, and we're not keeping it real. We've been telling our citizens that taxes are not going up, but we're being taxed through the Water Authority and through the Parking Authority, because if they don't bring the money in, we're in an even bigger hole. So let's get this straight. Let's stop with the political, whatever you want to call it. We got to set is straight. We do not have a plan to exit Act 47 unless we get all these houses that are vacant into the tax rolls and we get new companies to come in and invest. But we got to start believing in ourselves. We don't need superheroes to come in, and we don't need saviors. We are the solution to our own problems. Again, I say, there's no real plan to the citizens of Reading. There's no real plan to exit Act 47. They can feed you whatever you want. If you want to eat it, eat it. But let me tell you, I've been around these meetings for too long. And the only way is to stay in Act 47 till we get some houses and companies to come in and to invest. But besides that, there's no real exit plan. I've been to all these meetings and the same thing over and over again. What I suggest is that, and it's sad because we only have, there's, how many council people are they? Seven council people? There's only three council people that are attended this meeting. The mayor's not here, and they should all be here. Again, I say, there's no real plan to exit Act 47, and I'm looking forward to hearing the plan in the next 30 days. But again, there's no real plan. Give us in detail what the plan it is. The only way to get out of Act 47 is to get more people into houses, into the tax rolls, and companies to come in. But I've been hearing the same thing, and I don't think that we can exit Act 47 because there's no way getting out of Act 47 unless you tax the hell out of people, and we don't want that.
Good afternoon, Gordon. I'm Evelyn Morrison, Reverend Evelyn Morrison, and I am a lifelong resident, citizen, activist, advocate, but more importantly, concerned about the status of our city. And my area is civil rights. And when we talk about the legal promise of equality and equity, we're talking about a promise that the government made to its people, we the people, for the people, of the people, and by the people, so that we have inalienable rights, inviolable rights, that we can expect that promise to be made by those people that we elect to represent us, to make wise decisions, and to consult with us when things are not going so well. We have had a long history of a lack of citizen engagement and involvement, some intentionally by the citizens, some intentionally by the government representation. When we talk about a freedom to speak, that is one of our Bill of Rights, our constitutional rights. But when you're limited and you're restricted as to what you can say, how you can say it, that infringes on the very right of our government to allow us to express ourselves as citizens. Now, Gordon, when they engaged you, community and economic development, when they engaged you, where did you find the citizens in the organizational chart? Were they at the top? Were they there at all? Where were they in terms of the city's organizational chart? Do you remember? Oh, we can't have a dialogue. I'm so sorry. Okay, then I'll just say, we know that the citizens were the invisible sleeping giant. And the organizational structure that the mayor has, there's no citizens there, not at the top. And we said, when was this issued? It's incorrect. But that just goes to show how the people who make decisions about the city are really not concerned about the citizens, except times like this when it's time for election. And now we understand even more clear that when we, the people, began to initiate our rights within the context of our Home Rule Charter, to begin to solicit the support and the input of 2,000 plus citizens as to what their wishes were to put a ballot question on the next municipal ballot, more than 2,000 said, yes, we want to vote on the time, the amount of time, the length of time that our elected officials should be in office. So that began an interesting dialogue. We informed the city leaders of what the people are requesting. We did the footwork, house to house, apartment to apartment, even interviewed some homeless people, even though they didn't have a registration or an address, they still were a part of this survey. And so when the 2,000 plus people did sign and say, yes, we want to exercise our right to put it on the ballot, we knew that there was a ominous resistance. Why? Because the four majority members of city council that have been here more than 15 years, they vote in the majority. So we find that any time a vote is, but one day, one beautiful day, when they vote, they voted in this majority because John Slifko literally gave his life for this city. And he was wrong in the information that he gave us and that he gave city council. Because Fred, I'm glad you're here because you can attest to the fact that we went to Harrisburg to meet with representatives from the community and economic development to talk about our issues. And we were well received by our state government. And you know what I found out? That there's a lie going on in our city government about the power of the people. They, the legal team of this city that represents the administration and city council, coerced, and I use the word coerced because it was without option, but it was with much force for me and our people to use the municipal option plan in order to amend our charter. That told me that our law department doesn't represent the citizens, because in our charter, in Article 12, Section 104, it says very clearly three ways in which the charter can be amended. The first one is the citizens through the initiative process. The second is by city council. And the third is by the charter commission. So why have all these other ordinances and resolutions utilized that procedure, but when it was time for the people to exercise their power, that we had to be directed to the state, which is governed by the Community and Economic Development? It was a miscarriage of justice. Now let me tell you something. When we looked at the rights of the people, by her defying the legal department to say, when Ms. Morrison comes in to present the petition, accept it. So she defies that instruction, and she defiantly says, no, I'm not accepting it because it was late, with a behavior and an attitude that is unbecoming a servant of the people, a citizen. That's like the Pathonidary telling us, no, you can't file that. A violation of that law is bigger than you know, because it violates the very Bill of Rights, the Fifth Amendment, which gives us the due process. This promise I talked about, the legal and fair procedure when a citizen engages in their protected rights by the federal Constitution of the United States, the state Pennsylvania Constitution, and our Home Rule Charter. I take this very seriously because I remember there was a time in this country that people who looked like me and who was the color of me could not even vote. And we're talking about in my lifetime. And then I stand in my urban government center and get a rejection and feel history overwhelm me of the people who had to die so that I could vote and exercise my rights. We're talking Caucasian, we're talking African American, we're talking Latino American, we're talking all the peoples whose rights is protected by this government. That's the spirit of the law, and the spirit of the law is greater than the letter of the law. And when we came in the spirit of the law. Now, the reason why we were challenged is because there's an influence that overwhelms this city government, and it has nothing to do with the people. It has everything to do with the 30 Masons who have organized to begin to take power over the city schools, the city government, and the city economics. They've made a pact. One is called the King. The other is called the Mayor. Now that in itself is anarchy. When you already have a government that's in operation and recognized by all levels of government, including the people, and then you have a group coming, calling themselves the King, that represents a feudal system. And they've all paid $1 million to come and play. They bought properties that were more than $1 million. That was the entry fee. Now they thought nobody knew that, but if you follow the dollars, you'll see what's happening in the underground here. But I want to talk to you, and I'm going to be very brief. The city council voted a couple years back to forgive and dismiss 1 year, $21 million of federal money through HUD, the 108 loans, the BEDI loans, the EDI loans. Now why? Because those people who received those loans were all Caucasian, except one, one Latin American woman. Now, if the city council has the power to forgive loans, we asked why. And they told us it was because they couldn't find the business entities. Well, it just so happened that one of the borrowers began to work for the city at a $45,000 job. And so I thought for sure they would, eyes would be open and say, hey, you still owe us some money. And we'll garnish your wages and so you could pay us back. Now, HUD tells us that they looked at the monitoring process and they found some deficiencies. And those deficiencies was how we accounted for the monies and how we were not keeping good bookkeeping for these federal and state funds. So we knew then that this was more than just a oversight. It was now a plan to begin to take our federal monies and our state monies and allocate them to one nonprofit that City Council voted to be the lead developer in this city. And you know what we found? 145 businesses came from that same address. If you needed a realtor, they created a realty company. If you needed a property manager, they created a property manager. If you needed a holding company for the properties, they created the holding companies. So when we did our research and found that one name brought forth 145 businesses that received millions of dollars from the city, if that's not white collar crime, if that's not fraud, if that's not antitrust, I don't know what is. It just so happened he died. And when he died, all of his organized empire became vulnerable. And there is when we began to see how he did it. We call it the shell game. We call it the shell game. I come to you, and I'm a puppeteer politically because I pay you lots of money for your campaign, and I give you a lot of money for your campaign, and it's all recorded. And then I give you a lot of money. I ask someone else to give you a lot of money. And there we are in this pay to play. And then guess what happens? We start giving our city council little treats and bonuses. Like, for example, if I owe you money for taxes, I just make sure that I give you a $1,500 season ticket for my company, and you can get that for 5 years. Some of you reported it, some of you didn't. Now, the reason why we are broke is because our money has been stolen. They robbed the citizens. The reason why crime and public safety is such an issue is because the money that was supposed to train the next generation, to develop their businesses for the next generation, to provide housing for the next generation, has all been allocated to keep people in their $125,000 jobs, nonprofit, with one or two employees. And we continue to do much business with them. And we continue to sustain them when they promise the city, you will only need to sustain us for 5 years. Meanwhile, it's 35 years later, and you are still there taking money from the Community Development Block Grant. It goes on and on and on. This is a year that we vow as citizens to interrupt that process, and we will do whatever is necessary to engage the public to stand firmly on their rights. So I say to you, and I've given you a letter, and you can read it. The issue is simple. The issue is very simple. Today, let it be known that for those of us who have done the research, we want you to recommend a receivership for the city of Reading. And mind you, public, it doesn't mean that our assets get sold away. It doesn't mean that. It means there's going to be an evaluation on those assets to see what they can yield. And we, the public, should have the input on how our current assets should be brought back home. The parking authority, the water authority, all our authorities, the redevelopment authority, they have to come home. Before they left, we were fine. But now that they're gone and now being manipulated independently, we created a monster. So I'm saying to you, please consider the probability and the possibility of a receivership with the citizens involved, and we decide how it goes. You educate us, and that's a role of community and economic development. Your company, you have consulted from east to west, north to south in this nation. So you've picked up a lot of tricks of the trade, if you will. Your staff is some predominantly, they're wizards, because they have been able to go in and create some interesting outcomes. And your profitability margin has increased. So you're doing something right. And your old school approaches, they call them old fashioned, but they're not old fashioned. It's just old men being practical. And so I see from your business itself that you're putting something in place. You're not just talking out the side of your mouth, but your company is designed to do what it says it's going to do. And it's done that nationally. So I appreciate the fact that you've bared with us and have groaned with us. But now it's time to get real serious and begin to talk about the citizens want receivership. How do we make that happen for them? And how do we recreate this infrastructure? And we're willing to sacrifice. We know it's going to put the positions at a disadvantage. This election this year, they may not take their seats anyhow, if we have our way. That term limit proposed that if they already served 8+ years, that they could no longer sit in 2020. So that's going to clean house one way or another. And if we ask for a receivership and we begin that dialogue, because 3 years we can turn this in a receivership around. So I'm seriously talking about engaging the citizens in their own receivership and cut this bull out and let us be a government for the people, by the people, and of the people. And I told HUD, they've been sued before for malfeasance and mismanagement and allowing things to be under monitored. And I said to them, hold back the money, hold it back and see who squirms. We the people weren't, we won't, because we won't miss it, what we never had. Now we can create jobs and training for these young African, Latin, Caucasian men and women who need jobs in this city. And then our training programs will lead them to want to be homeowners. And as homeowners, it will encourage them to become their businesses, well-organized, well-developed businesses, that they can do business with the government as minority entrepreneurs, as multicultural entrepreneurs. That's the kind of plan we need to raise from the ashes. This city has always been a phoenix. It will always come up out of the dirt. The same people in Why Missing that want to take over, they were the kids with snotty nose here 60 years ago, and then forgot their identity when they moved to the suburbs and forgot that they were born, raised, and educated in Reading. And now they want to come back and command the opportunity of a dying city. People invest in bull markets and they invest in bear markets. There are a lot of people that invested in the demise of this city and have yielded billions of dollars. The community and economic development secretary, what's his name? Dennis Devlin. You know what he said in June of last year? He said, "Ms. Morrison, we have sent billions of dollars to Reading, Pennsylvania, and we have nothing to show for it." I looked at him, what a candid and direct truth. I said, "Well, now it's time to make a change, don't you think? We'll create our own relationships with community and economic development and cut out the middleman by becoming our own nonprofits or replacing those people that have been the obstacles in our development way, and then be able to recreate a relationship with the government that's going to be of the people and for the people, and of course by the people. So my heart is coming out to you. I'm talking about the violation of our civil rights by the theft of our monies. I'm talking about the violation of legal and fair procedures. And we have had city council members say in their closed meetings, the citizens don't have to know that. They don't need to know that. Anytime you have representatives that are of that mindset, beware, because they're about to do things that only benefit them. So we're ready for a change, and let it be a drastic one, let it be a well-designed one, and a well-thought-out one, so that everybody has a vested interest, and that we see this next generation in Reading flourish. And these buildings, look, they keep the roof windows open and the third story windows open so the elements can go in there and deteriorate them so that they can tear them down. So why would we even want to invest in a city that's crumbling down unless we have a plan that will make money on that market? So my brother, I say to you, do not be afraid to think out of the staying in recovery box. Let us begin to think about what are the options to get outside of that box and look at receivership in the most creative, practical, effective way in which we can recapture all of our authorities and bring them home, and then begin to work with our assets inside. And let us tighten our belts as citizens. And if it means that we have to go a distance for the next 3 years, let us do it. Because that will show that we have an investment in our redevelopment of our city from the ground up. So don't be afraid to even think about receivership, because some of us are ready to have that discussion. Amen? Amen.
If there are no further comments, I'm going to call the public meeting to close. Some of you have submitted written comments. I appreciate that. The deadline for submitting written comments is technically tomorrow. But, you know, if you have written comments that you want to submit before the end of next week, that is not a problem. Most of you know how to get a hold of me. I appreciate everyone coming, your passion and your interest in your comments tonight. And with that, we will consider the public meeting adjourned.